George Crowe, born in Austin, Texas, while my mom was an undergrad at the University of Texas, and my dad had come back to work on his PhD after serving 4 years in the Pacific. So I grew up, you know, hearing about all the hook'em horns. My dad became a college professor. We lived in New Mexico. We lived in Germany. We lived in Bogota, Colombia, in Latin America, where he was president of a school for a while. Then he took a job at Texas Christian University. Some of the happiest days of my life is back when the Southwest Conference was really a national powerhouse, and my mom didn't like to go to the games, and they gave faculty free passes then, so I'd go with my dad, and some of you guys won't remember these names, but others of you will. Got to see Don Meredith play for Dallas, and got to see Ronnie Bull running for Baylor, and got to watch my hero Bob Lilly for the Dallas Cowboys. And then my dad had the unmitigated gall to accept a job at an all-girls school. So we moved when I was in the eighth grade to Rock Hill, South Carolina, for my dad to be the head of his department at Winthrop College back then, an all-girls school. It's not just at Rotary these things happen, John. It's everywhere. It's a good thing. Good thing. But by the time I graduated from high school, it seemed to be a pretty good thing to be in a town with an all-girls school. I went off to the Air Force Academy. That had been a childhood dream. Served my time in the academy. Graduated, gave up my UPT slot, my regular flying slot, because I'd fallen in love with helicopters. So I flew helicopters for 5 years. I flew in Vietnam. People think I was a chaplain. I was actually a gunship helicopter pilot in Vietnam, trying to pick up reconnaissance teams that got in trouble. Got out of the military, left Vietnam, went back to Florida. Spent my last 2.5 years in the beautiful Panama Canal Zone. At some point there, I'd made a commitment to the Lord. When I got out of the Air Force, I had a chance to go back to pilot training, but Vietnam had fallen, and you know, I just didn't think they needed any more pilots, so I got out of the Air Force. I went to what's now called Columbia International University. I was going to study there a year or two, then try to go to law school or business school. Met my wife there, who would not have given me the time of day had she known I was going to end up in the pastorate. But we got married, started going to a Presbyterian church. I was a mongrel background. You know, Bogota's one thing, Germany's one thing, military chapels are another, and she was a Southern Baptist. That's where we became Presbyterians. Changed my major to the seminary degree. When I graduated, I was working at Central Correctional Institute in a chaplain training program, and I got a call asking if I wanted to start a new Presbyterian church here in Northeast Columbia. So our first worship service was down the road about half a mile in the gymnasium of what is now St. John Newman School. I've been here now almost 36 years, so in 36 years, I've moved all of half a mile. How's that for being on the real fast track? The trivia about me, I want you to know I am really one smart guy. I graduated class of 1970, United States Air Force Academy. In my graduating class, there were two Rhodes Scholars, George Keyes and Scott Barker. But I want you to know you are looking at the salutatorian of my particular graduating class in 1970. Two Rhodes Scholars, and you all are looking at the salutatorian. Thank you. However, that is the truth, and it's nothing but the truth, but it's not the whole truth. 25 of us were asked for, don't need to go into that, were asked to delay our graduation about 3 weeks. And then two of us got caught with motorcycles and were asked to delay our graduation 3 more days. So even though I'm part of the class of 1970, 730 of them graduated June 3, but only two of us graduated June 30, 1970. But I was salutatorian. Let's see, my classification, religion, Presbyterian. I was sponsored by Phil Walpole, joined in February 1983. Committees I've been on, membership, scholarship, club service. Health and happiness, I think I started in 1985 when Ben Nesbitt was the president. I did that about 5 years, and then in the late 80s, they asked me to do programs in addition to that, so I did that. Finally decided I couldn't do both of them, so they said, gave the programs to somebody else, so I did health and happiness another 5 or 6 years, And then when Tom Ayers became president, I believe that's when it was, in the late 90s, he asked me to do programs again. I said, I can't do programs in health and happiness, but I think they were tired of my corny jokes. So they said, take programs, and I've been doing that lately, though the baton may be passed, but I'm so thankful to people like Diane Junis and Elise Bidwell and Doug Bridges and Julian Gibbons for coming up with most of our speakers. Been married 39 years this August. I have a daughter, Emily, works Bank of America in Charlotte, North Carolina. Son, Daniel, who just got his PhD at the University of Wisconsin. They both went to North Springs Elementary School, Summit Parkway Middle School, and Spring Valley High School. And so we're very grateful to Richland, too. They have been good to us. But enough about me. I want to introduce to you now the eminent Aaron Small. Aaron was raised here in Columbia, and he graduated from Dreher High School. He had a job in high school working in a funeral home, even so much so that he would spend the weekends there. And so that's what he did during his high school career. Well, at some point, I may get all the dates wrong, but you can ask Beth. Maybe she'll remember them. He went to the emergency room, and that's, I guess, on business, and he met a nursing student, Beth Small, to whom he has now been married for 53 years. But they got married during the time of the draft. Some of you all remember the draft. So Aaron was drafted, and because of his background, he served in the U.S. Army in mortuary affairs, up at Fort Bragg, I believe. Then he got out. He'd always had a dream to be a fireman. But he found out, what was it, in the mid-60s or whenever it was, they got paid $7,000 a year. And he couldn't support his wife and two children on $7,000 a year. So he went with a friend to Myrtle Beach, somebody McMillan, and they started McMillan Small Funeral Home, which is still existent today. He sold his part to his partner in 1985, and then he went back to his childhood dream. He'd been serving as a volunteer fireman. He started working for the Horry County Fire Department. And if you recall, if you know, firemen work 24 hours and they're off 48. Well, during his off 48, this entrepreneur started selling fire engines to other fire departments here in South Carolina. How mortuary and fire go together, I have no idea. That must be a God thing, I guess. And then he retired about 5 years ago, and he and Beth moved back here to Columbia, and he works part-time with the Shives Funeral Home. And one of the interesting tidbits about Aaron is he's probably heard more sermons about Jesus and heaven and life and death than anyone in this room, but he's a member in good standing of Beth Shalom Synagogue. So would you welcome my friend Aaron Small, a member of the Forest Acres Rotary Club, who loves his God, loves his family, really loves this country. And I thought what he had to say would be so great on this last Thursday before Memorial Day weekend. So join me in welcoming Aaron Small.
Thank you all for having me. President Bill, thank you for the opportunity to be here. What I'd like to say today is pretty much involve all of you folks who are here, because everyday heroes are individuals with great skills, courage, and perseverance. They may risk and give their lives, or they may be dedicated to live to improving our health, our welfare, our educational system. Many of these individuals have endured numerous challenges in order to put us first. And I want to ask you, what is it going to take to keep our country safe and take it back? It's not about being a Democrat. It's not about being an independent or a Republican. It's about being an American. For more than 238 years, the American flag has been a symbol of our nation's strength and unity. Our flag has been a source of pride, inspiration, obedience, and a prominent icon for our nation. Across this great nation and throughout the world, Americans have paused to honor our brave fighting women and men who have underwritten our freedom. When you see what is happening in the world with genocides, freedoms to worship, freedoms to vote, freedom to live in a safe environment, we are truly very fortunate to live in America. We struggle with the eternal debt that we owe our men and women of America fighting forces who have assured our well-being in our great nation, and those who have paid the ultimate price for our democracy, and our local emergency workers who keep us safe daily. I served 18 months in the U.S. Army mortuary section, and during that time we cared for about 210 members of all branches of the military. When we received the death of one of our service members, It was called a solemn, dignified transfer. Our duty was to return these military members with an escort to their final resting place with dignity and respect as they made their journey home to their loved ones. Time when I reflect back on my service in the mortuary section, I don't remember many of the names of those that I served. But as I inspected the final dressing and the placement in the casket, I will always remember their faces. For me, it was someone's loved one. And I was part of that solemn, dignified transfer for their final trip back home to their families in their final resting place. After the final inspection, it was sometimes difficult for me as we placed the American flag of our nation over the casket. I was struggling with the sadness of their lives ending, but I was also grateful to have served with those who were willing to be part of our nation's military and to give up their lives if it was necessary. Today, 50 years later, after serving the U.S. Army Mortuary Section, when I opened the back door of the funeral coach at their final resting place and the American flag is draped in the casket, for me, it is still a signified, dignified transfer. For those of you who have served in the military, in honor of the flag of the United States, I salute you. May God bless you, keep America safe, and I will never apologize for saying, God bless America. Thank you. Thank you.
Abraham Lincoln, 16th President of these United States, is everlasting in the memory of his countrymen. For on the battleground at Gettysburg, this is what he said. He said that from these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain. And that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall not perish from the earth.
One of the volunteer directors at the National Cemetery, Colonel Benson.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here this afternoon. Great lunch, good camaraderie, and I just want to impart a few words. I first was exposed to this when my brother came home in a pine box when I was 15 years old, and he had an escort. He had been training to be helicopter pilot in Korea, and the training failed. So that was my first exposure to something like this. Then I subsequently graduated from college, which was a blessing by itself. And then I spent 23 years in the Army and retired as a colonel. Then I retired 32 years ago. My last 7 years was at the Pentagon and on Capitol Hill, and that's enough to make anybody retire. Which I gladly did after that. 7 straight years of, anyway, it was kind of weird. I can't use words in church. But I was in Vietnam as a medic, but I was a medic to the South Vietnamese Army. I was not with the American troops. And a couple of things were exposed to me over there, culture-wise and what have you. Their first impression is to take care of the dead, not the living. That's your culture and that's your religion. They believe in reincarnation. You went out on the battlefield if they were missing a limb and you found a limb, so that they would be complete when they were reincarnated. And the caskets or the coffins that they were buried in had to be cut from one piece of wood so that the body would be inside a living organism and they would be returned to earth that way. So you would have 4 pieces of wood cut from the same log and then they would be buried in that. That's a little different than what we were exposed to here in this country. And it's a lot different in the medical way of treating people. We try to take care of the living first, you know, stop the blood and take care of those that can be saved. So you had to step back and say, well, we're in their country now and we're in their culture. And they have been fighting for years. So you have to understand and kind of take a step backwards and say, do the best you can. But that's the way it goes. At the National Cemetery, and George is here, he was one of the base members of that thing, getting it going, what have you, and it was great. It's a beautiful place. How many of you are veterans? How many of you have been to the National Cemetery out here at Fort Jackson? If you have not yet been there, I urge you to go. they've opened the whole thing up now. They finally got everything taken care of. In January, they opened that up. It's beautiful. And if you have time tomorrow at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, you can help us plant flags at each headstone, 3,600 headstones. And we have initially, when there were like 200 out there on the first Memorial Day, because it's open in January, cold that day too. We had maybe 5 or 10 volunteers, and it took us a while. It's real hard to put a flag in sand that doesn't hold anything. You know, they all go this way when you get it there. So right now we have a great number of volunteers, thank goodness, but we always can use more. Because 3,600 headstones out there take a while. But with the number of volunteers that we've had and the flags that are donated by Legion Club up in Elgin, it can take maybe 15 minutes, and it's like a big wave. They grab the flags, and everybody goes and scatters. The first ones that are offered flags are spouses and family members of somebody who was buried there. So that's an honor for them to do. This is not advertised. You know, this is not a fun and games event. This is to honor somebody who's out there. And families spread the word by word of mouth, and they get their families and friends to come out and help them. That's important, that they have support out there. And then we'll do it around Christmas time, where they call Wreaths Across America. And that is, a wreath is placed by every headstone. By then, we expect to have around 4,000. There's 500 acres out there, so we're looking at maybe 150 to 200,000 possible places. That will outlast me, I can tell you that. I'm 76, and it's certainly not going to be many more years when they get out there. But there's a couple other things that I'd like to just talk to you about. One of them is called, it's now called Missing in America. And this is for individuals who are homeless, die in a hospital, any hospital, what have you. But it came to light about 5 years ago when another gentleman and myself met with the two coroners, Lexington County and Richland County, and the VA, Veterans Administration. And they said, we have remains on our shelves that are over 15 years old. We don't know who they are. We don't know who they belong to. But at that point in time, it was costing money, and money talks, costing money to have them buried in the pauper's grave out there. And they said, if they're veterans, would they not be eligible for the cemetery at Fort Jackson? We said, heck yeah. But to find out who somebody is, and where they came from and who their families are, is not easy. You know, you might have a homeless person here who came from Portland, Oregon, or who came from Montana or something like that. You cannot put that name in every paper in the United States to try to find out who their next of kin is. So when they're missing in America, we're talking about people who are buried with no family. That is not right. So the first time we got together with the two coroners, and we said, let's go through the paperwork, not me. This is a very exacting business that has to go through mostly St. Louis, Missouri. That's where the records are kept. And so they did that and found that there are a few people eligible. The first person that was buried out there, probably 4 years ago, there were two people there, myself and a chaplain from our unit. And that was it. They represented the family. The only thing we knew were 4 days. The date of their birth, the date they entered the service, the date they left the service, and when they died. had no idea of any other information about him. That too is sad, because if you think you're going to leave this world and nobody know who you are, where you came from, where your life was, where your families were, or something like that, that's pretty sad. So we're trying to find people. So far we've had, I imagine, 100 burials out there. Now the other thing that's been interesting is we've also engaged the Department of Juvenile Justice. They have young men and women that need to contribute some time to some worthwhile endeavors, and while they're in there, some of them are learning woodcrafting. And the first time we had 7 burials at one time, we ended up with 7 boxes with the remains of 7 different sizes, shapes, wood, everything like that. And you know, it was a good try, but it was the best they did at that time. The last time we had one, which was about probably 3 months ago, we had 13. Those boxes were perfect. They were all lined up. We had 8 Army, 2 Navy, and 3 Air Force. And all of them were perfectly grain, perfect grain wood. All of them had brass plaque on it with their name, who they were, what have you. Again, no family representatives. But who came along was about 100 motorcyclists, the Legion riders and other riders. Some of these had come from Sumter, some of these had come from Anderson, had been on the shelf for years. And the coroners were very happy, but it was very, very dignified. And to have somebody come along and stand as a comrade in arms, we're saying, but you were a comrade in arms. That's it. That's important. That somebody's representing them. And that's what it needs to be. When you're talking about the flag of the United States, people who go over and sometimes they don't come back. A member of this church is my next door neighbor, John Cummer, and he was in Normandy. In the Navy, he drove a boat for the British, but that's okay. He drove a Navy boat. He made, I think, 13 landings that particular day on D-Day. And he and I sit and talk about war stories all the time. I mean, it's great. He's a nice guy. But when you're talking about Missing in America, that is a program. You can go on the web and find it, Missing in America. And you see that there are chapters all over the country. It's slowly taking hold that somebody needs to represent these people who have lost their way in life, some of them because of sickness, some of them because of mentally they're not together anymore, and some of them have just drifted. The last time we had one, we did have one individual, a sister, come from either Idaho or Montana, heard about it, and so she was there to be with her brother. Fantastic. Fantastic. But you can't reach them all. There's no way you can reach everybody. So I'll just close by saying, I don't think any of you want to be buried alone. And that's the approach we take with the ones at the cemetery. Thank you.